Hi, I'm Jenny Brockie. Tonight on Insight, how free is our speech and how free should it be?
I mean, the poster itself is quite confronting.
It shows free speech in action in many ways.
There's a difference between what is right and what you have a right to do.
You feel you've got pretty much the right to say whatever you feel like saying.
I believe all Australians
on this
do.
Topic. Does anyone find that offensive? Welcome everyone, good to have you all here. Kieran Butler, about 18 months ago you decided to host a comedy debate in Melbourne. What was the topic?
The topic was there's nothing funny about rape.
And we have a poster here of the ad for the comedy debate. Angelo, it was your idea, is that right?
It was.
Why did you decide on the topic there's nothing funny about rape? Why did you think that was worth a debate?
Well, there'd been an incident in the US involving Daniel Tosh, who's a famous American comedian who'd made a rape joke, and so a lot of my friends who are comedians on Facebook were talking about it, and I thought it was appropriate and timely to have a conversation and a debate about the topic. And it seemed like an interesting topic and a lot of material to mine in terms of different comedians' perspectives on it and whether it's an appropriate topic for comedians to make jokes about or not.
So. Okay, so being a debate, the topic there's nothing funny about rape, there was another side that was arguing there was something funny about rape.
As in rape jokes?
Yeah, like you had the two sides of a debate, so
yes.
There would be... Yeah, but it didn't say rape jokes, it said rape.
No.
So it looked like a debate about whether there was something funny about rape.
Possibly, yes.
Yeah,
It was the intent, though.
Genevieve, how did you react when you saw this event advertised, when you saw that poster?
Well, I mean, the poster itself is quite confronting. As a young woman who is a survivor of sexual assault, I found it quite... It made me quite nervous, quite anxious looking at that.
So what did you do?
So a few friends and I who had seen this event on Facebook... posted the poster to the Facebook wall of the Destroy the Joint Facebook page. Then quite a few people obviously also saw the issue with it and started tweeting and Facebooking about it. Apparently some people called the venue, Station 59, and complained about it, and eventually the owner of the pub, or the manager at least, said that the debate was not going to be going ahead.
Did you call? Did you
no,
call the venue to get
call.
It shut down?
I didn't
did you want
call.
It shut down?
I did, yeah.
Kieran, what happened?
I got a phone call from the venue manager who said to me, you know, what's this all about? And I said, well, we should just go ahead with it. I know that there's some people complaining, but he said that it had been ramped up from complaining to threats of violence against his person, against the venue itself, and it was under the threats of the violence that he thought might escalate as a result. That was the reason that he took the decision to cancel it. That was what happened.
Yeah. Genevieve, were you aware of threats of violence or anything like that?
Not until the actual night of when the debate was meant to be happening, when Kieran mentioned it on stage, and I was quite horrified because...
But you wanted to stop it.
I wanted to stop it, absolutely, but I do not condone on any level threatening somebody with violence to do that.
But that was the way it got stopped. It didn't get stopped because anybody rang and complained. I think that you need to understand that the venue manager didn't call off the debate because there was a possibility that some people might be offended in the future, or that the topic was offensive, or the poster which Rob had made by himself and apologised for was offensive. He shut down the debate because he was fearful for his property, the property of the business that he ran. He was fearful for his own person and for his family. And all of it needs to be put in that context, that when you censor something using those methods, I think that's highly problematic.
So you feel your freedom of speech was impinged by this campaign to shut down the debate?
Yeah, of course their freedom of speech was impinged. And it has to always be in the context that it had to be escalating it. People who get very fundamentalist about ideas very quickly feel that they're justified in making threats of violence. And the threats got worse after it was cancelled. Like, once it was cancelled, the threats got even worse. There was threats to rape the owner's children. Like, once people seem to get let off the leash on this sort of stuff, then what happens is everybody gets a bee in their bonnet and there's a lot of white heat sort of rage, I think.
OK, quick response from you, Genevieve, and we'll move on.
I absolutely don't condone any of the threats of violence or anything, and I think that's horrible that that happened. But also I think that what Kieran's saying here means it's a fundamental misunderstanding of the concept of free speech. You're allowed to say things, but that doesn't mean that you have a guaranteed right to a platform on which to say them.
Angelo, can you understand why some people found this whole idea offensive or not? Can you not see why it would be offensive as a concept?
Angelo and I were in agreement that if we were both in agreement... Just to frame what our...
Can Angelo speak for himself?
Yeah, I know, but I think it's important to...
I would actually like him to speak for himself. Go on.
I think, just by way of a very poor excuse, I mean, we're very, very amateur players at this end of the spectrum, and, you know, if we get 15 or 20 people attend an event, we're excited, and it never occurred to us that this would take a life that it did.
Adrian, you do a comedy routine about rape called Asking For It, where you're naked from the waist down, I think, for your routine. How do you make rape... Mm-hmm. funny, and do you think that your routine is offensive to some people?
I believe really strongly that comedy and satire remains one of the sharpest and best ways to talk about all sorts of difficult topics that are political and loaded. So I decided that comedy would be a good tool for me to talk about the things that interested me about rape culture, about how rape is spoken about and dealt with politically, socially, and also about how it's joked about. To clarify, I don't find there to be anything funny about rape. I find there are things that you can, that are easy targets for satire and how people think and talk about it.
So what do you think about this debate then being shut down? What's your view about that?
I have a pretty complex view about it. I've done other shows that have been threatened by outsiders and protested, people who wanted the show stopped. I've had, in an act I do called the Vava Sisters, we had our lives quite seriously threatened for the material we were doing by people who hadn't seen our show.
Yeah, but what do you think? Should it have been shut down or not?
I wouldn't shut down a show. I'd rather hear difficult topics discussed in an open forum, but I certainly would have questioned the open-mindedness or in the agenda of the people putting it together not to endeavor to get some female comics on that panel. Mm.
Did you not think it might be a good idea to have a female on the panel?
In retrospect, 1,000 times so. But, yeah, at the time, it stupidly didn't occur to me.
I'm just wondering what people think it says about free speech. Tim, what do you think it says about free speech, an example like this?
Well, I think the example like this shows free speech in action in many ways, because you had a very poor taste event being organised, and then you had somebody responding quite sensibly, highlighting the fact that it was a very poor taste event, and then people largely exercising their voice in protest against it. The problem is that it then turned to violence or allegations of violence, and I'm taking that on trust from you, but that there were allegations of violence, and that's outside of the domain, because there are laws that deal with threatening speech or speech that incites violence, which is a very different proposition because it comes very much in direct with other human, in conflict with other human rights. But so long as people are only protesting, and the owner of the venue may have withdrawn the right to use it because they may have decided it was a poor taste of it itself, that is their right. And so I actually think the action of just putting it up on a website and highlighting and using your speech to highlight how poor in taste this event was is an entirely rational and sensible response.
So that's kind of the market forces at work free speech.
It's the market forces at work, but it's free speech working and correcting the problems in society. Rather than trying to silence people, we should be encouraging more people to stand up, speak out and say what they think is unacceptable.
it's about context and it's about nuance, and it is a very delicate topic, so it does need to be handled delicately.
OK. I want to move on. We've got some other examples. Sergio, you've painted this mural on the outside wall of your property in Newtown. You've painted a series of murals, actually. I think over 80 of them.
That's
on the wall.
That's one of the last ones.
Why?
It started in 2010 when a mate of mine, who happens to be gay, wanted to use burkas in a fashion parade, part of the Fringe Festival in Moore Theatre. And he basically talked about it online, and it got back to him, good or bad, that if he actually did use burkas over his fetish leather gear that he designs, his shop would be firebombed. And he actually then censored himself out of fear of the threat. And I've been living in Newtown at that point for 20 plus years, and I couldn't believe that anyone in Newtown would actually be threatened in the first place, because we're a community that is fairly open-minded. And so I started the topic by doing a mural saying, say no to burkas.
So what exactly was the conversation you wanted to have?
About full-face coverings, and behind it, this threat, that underlying threat, that if you actually make a comment about certain cultural elements, there's a risk factor involved.
OK, we have to take you on trust on that. I mean, there's no way that I can know if that actually happened, or, you know, it's about third hand.
Yes, so 4 years down the line, 4 years down the line, I have personally experienced the violence and physical violence by the sheer fact of just expressing myself on a topic of clothing.
You express yourself quite vociferously. You've got a truck that you drive around as well. I think we've got a picture of that. Can you... do you understand that's offensive to some people?
They can be as offended as they like, but they don't have the right to cross the line and threaten me, injure me, my family or my friends. And that's the difference. It's like, I really believe in who we are as Australians. And part of that is the conversation that we can and should be able to have any conversation, no matter how distasteful it is, to get to the other end of it.
Do you feel you've got the right to say pretty much whatever you want to say about this?
I believe if we have a system that someone may cross the line, but then it doesn't mean that they have, you know, no one has the right to hurt them for crossing the line. We have plenty of laws in Australia that protect myself.
No, but just getting back to my question, you feel you've got pretty much the right to say whatever you feel like saying.
I believe all Australians
on this
do.
Topic. Okay. Chittam, you tried to take Sergio to the New South Wales Anti-Discrimination Board over one of the murals. Which one and why?
Say no to burkas.
And what happened?
Well, you know, I made the complaint, and 2 weeks after making the complaint, Sergio took my complaint, which was meant to be confidential. He took it to 2GB Radio, which has millions of listeners. And the presenter, along with Sergio, read my complaint, ridiculing it in that kind of public platform. 1 week after that, Fred Nile brought up my complaint in the New South Wales Parliament, trying to stop the investigation in its tracks. He wasn't complaining that I had won the case or even received legal representation, but just the fact that I had made the complaint was so problematic that it had to be raised in the New South Wales Parliament.
Why did you want a legal remedy?
I think, you know, you grow up, you study legal studies at school, you have this general idea that, you know, we live in a just country. We've got laws that protect us. It's not just about privileged groups.
What about the argument that he has a right to paint whatever he likes?
Then everyone else should have a right to, you know, paint whatever they like in whichever building they like. I mean, where's the equal platform? I don't have a building that I can put my response to that.
But this is his own house. This is the wall on his own house, so he has that right.
Absolutely, but it's also facing the rail tracks. So every train that passes Newtown sees that. It's very visible, it's very large. And the thing is, public space belongs to the public. It doesn't belong to white, privileged men.
Do you think he has a right to express the views he expresses?
Absolutely, absolutely. He can get in with his group of friends, male friends, talking about what women should wear and shouldn't wear. He has absolutely every right. But when it comes to the public space, that public space belongs to everyone. It doesn't belong just to him.
you took it to the New South Wales Anti-Discrimination Board and it was knocked back because it was about religion. Is that right?
Well, it wasn't actually knocked back. It was investigated. The whole process took about 6 months. At the end of the 6 months, Legal Aid decided that they would represent me. But then just when they decided to represent me, I had to sit in a room with all these lawyers who told me all these facts. So, you know, if I did decide to pursue with the case, then life could actually be much worse for veiled Muslim women in New South Wales because they'd be receiving, increased focus on the hijab. They also said that I'd be receiving personal attacks for up to 10 years because legal cases can usually take a very long time to be processed. And if I was attacked personally through defamation, I wouldn't be able to receive the support of Legal Aid. So I'd have to withstand that. I just think that's really unfair. I mean, it became so daunting that I had to leave it.
OK, so how do people feel about what Sergio does in terms of free speech? I'd just like to get a few opinions about that.
I just wanted to say, when as a Muslim woman who's already persecuted all, like, widely in Australia, if you go past that place on a train and you see a picture, ultimately, of yourself and your identity reflecting back at you with a cross through it, like a no-smoking sign, imagine your picture on the side of my building or anyone else's building and puts a cross through you.
They did it. They put stickers everywhere doing that all over.
That's you personally. It's not you as a group. You're attacking people who haven't done anything wrong.
But do you think he has a right to express it?
Absolutely not, because it's way, way more damaging to those people and to the ongoing persecution of Muslim people. I'm not Muslim
So you think
either.
It should be against the law in some way?
I think there should be a limit.
Yeah, OK. Natalie, what do you think?
As a lawyer, one of the first things they told us in law school is the law isn't justice, it's just a process. Not every social problem requires a legal answer. And I think we have to remember that there's a difference between what is right and what you have a right to do. So I think a lot of people in this room will agree that perhaps what was done was in poor taste and it perhaps wasn't right, but that is a separate issue to whether he has a right to do it.
Do you think he has a right to do it?
I actually do. I actually might surprise a lot of people. I am a believer in quite a high level of freedom of speech. I think that in terms of the law, it's not the law's place to determine those levels. I think things like communities taking action, freedom of speech in response is the appropriate way to go.
So where do you have a line with that? Like, is there a line beyond which you wouldn't think it was okay?
I'm not sure where to draw the line. We just find it funny that we draw the line at religion or sex or whatever. So a footballer who says, oh, you're a black oh, that's offensive. But if you say, oh, no, I didn't say that. I said, you're a dumb oh, that's all right. For some reason, we draw the line at the black rather than the And, OK, another example...
I think SBS may well find it.
But you get the...
But it's just drawn line.
But you get the point that... OK, but you get the point that you seem to be offended about that aspect, the black aspect, rather than the other one.
So you're asking why are we so sensitive about race?
We get sensitive about race, religion... And, OK, the Anti-Discrimination Act is what? Race, religion, but not other things.
Michael, you were abused in a public park while you were walking your dog. What were you called?
I was called by a gentleman of somewhat more years than myself, and I'm not that young either, but a big, fat Jewish slob. And he then went on to say that Hitler was right about you bastards. And out of earshot of the other witnesses said, I'd like to guess you bastard.
How did you react?
I turned round on my feet, ran back about 50 metres, and I am a rather large gentleman, and said to this person, I'm not in the habit of going around hitting 79-year-olds, but you are surely trying my patience. At that point, someone else came between us. As far as I was concerned, that was it. I would point out that, yes, I am Jewish, and, yes, I've been subject to all sorts of jokes and ridicules, like other people live all my life. I'm fairly thick-skinned. Having served in the forces for many years, it makes you so. But I was particularly prickled about that. It hit a raw nerve, and for whatever reason, I thought of my father, because if you look at the pictures of Bergen-Belsen in Germany and you see the bulldozers bulldozing the bodies, my father had the dubious honour of organising that. And for whatever reason, I flashed to it. It made me angry.
Now, you made a complaint and you wanted an apology, but you didn't get one. Why?
I, if you like, lost the case on points because the way the Act is worded, and I'm not a lawyer, I'm not a layperson in the law or anything like that, basically, not enough people had heard it. One person heard it fully, one person sort of heard it, but there have to be three or more.
So this was around the issue of incitement, whether
Correct.
It would incite others.
Correct.
So the lack of there being more than one person meant that it didn't meet the incitement requirements.
That's correct.
What did you think about that decision?
I accepted it because it was the law. I felt that I'd won what I wanted because the gentleman concerned had to spend time in the city of Melbourne. We live some area away. He had to be cross-examined by myself and by the lady on the bench. And he was shown up to be what he was, which is rather stupid. All I wanted him to do was to make a public apology to the Jewish religion as a whole and spend one day at the Holocaust Museum in a suburb of Melbourne finding out that Hitler wasn't right.
But you didn't get that.
I didn't get that.
But you did feel vindicated in inconveniencing him in some sense?
Yeah, the fact that he didn't get away with it in the schoolyard, so to speak. He'd had to go and see the principal. Hmm. I felt that was enough.
What do people think about that? I mean, should the law apply to a situation like that? Is that something that should be actionable? What do people think?
I think it shows that the law perhaps wasn't as effective in getting the result that he wanted there.
What do you think, Tim?
Well, I think that's absolutely right. The problem we're often talking about is what is lawful and what is unacceptable, and they're different things. The law is an imperfect instrument, particularly when we're dealing with things like speech, because, of course, 22 million people are exercising it, often all consistently at the same time. And if we actually want to tackle a lot of these issues, we have to get beyond the law and focus on cultural change, education, programs that actually enable us to change societal attitudes to address them. So what we have is a situation which is imperfect and demonstrates why law is not the perfect answer.
I don't think the people who called me a brown bee stopped and thought, oh wait, does 18C apply? No, I'm not going to say that.
Well, the federal government wants to change the Federal Racial Discrimination Act, saying we need freer speech. Tim Wilson, you're the Human Rights Commissioner. You're supporting the proposed changes. Why?
What I've actually said is that the proposed changes are a good place to start and have a discussion about how the law should be changed. What we started with is a blank canvas and say all speech is legal until it's made explicitly illegal. You cut off bits, things like incitement to violence. That is clearly illegal. And currently we have a tension in the Federal Racial Discrimination Act, which draws the line at insult, offend, humiliate or intimidate. And the federal government has removed insult, offend, and humiliate and put in the word vilification with a definition as well as the word intimidate. And I think it's the good basis to start a conversation about how we can change the focus of the Racial Discrimination Act.
OK, so offend, insult, humiliate is out under these proposals. Intimidate stays, vilify is added. Simon, you're against these proposals. Why?
There are two stages. One is what's wrong with what we have. It's been in place for nearly 20 years. It's worked very well to introduce a perception in society around what might be the limits of speech. So I'm against this for fixing what ain't broke. That's the first point. If it is going to be fixed, then what's proposed is such a radical departure from what we have now. It goes way beyond the higher threshold that the states and territories have to a whole new, narrow, very small area of protection.
So what would people be able to do under these proposals that they can't do now?
Well, the significant thing is what the exception is. And the exception is for anything, and I mean anything, use your imagination, anything that is done, quote, in the course of public discussion. So if what you want to say or do, perform, act, articulate, you're doing ostensibly in public discussion, which these days is social media as much as a soapbox on the corner, will be permitted under these laws. In other words, there will no longer be a limit on free speech in public discussion. There will no longer be a racial speech limit on anything said in public discourse.
What it's saying, Jenny, is you can vilify and you can intimidate as long as you do so publicly. In a public discussion on any social, religious and a whole bunch of other adjectives matter.
And what do you think of that
idea? I think it's completely ludicrous. I cannot see the point of the act at all. I agree personally with raising the bar a bit from where it currently stands in terms of what is unlawful. And you can certainly argue about what vilify means, and maybe the definition's too high and so on, and this is the sort of thing we can discuss. But having decided you're going to raise the bar to the extent of only vilification and intimidation are unlawful, I don't think you should have any qualification on that.
Tim?
Well, this is exactly why it's an exposure draft, and I think some of the shortcomings of the proposal are coming out. There's an exposure draft that had been put out there to...
It's up for discussion.
To highlight some of the shortcomings of the proposal.
Which is why we're discussing it.
And these are some of the things. I have my own reservations around how some sections of it are worded, and the Australian Human Rights Commission will be making its own submission about how some of those proposals should be changed.
So, where are your reservations?
Well, I have a number of reservations, perhaps about how certain words are defined, whether it does cover the scope, whether it does create an unnecessarily high standard, and that's why I think we need to look at this
proposal. So you have concerns about words like intimidate and vilify, the ones that are going to be used outside...
I don't want to breach confidence and say what's in the submission before
it's
publicly...
Well, there are only two words that are in there.
There are, but, you know, there are also... some people have raised issues around what's called subsection 3, which is dealing with how the assessment is made on the different parts of the proposal and whether that needs to be amended as well.
Why do you think there's a need for change?
I think there's a need for change because, yes, there's a very serious issue about equality before the law, where you don't have somebody who is deemed a reasonable person of the Australian community, recognising limitations and the circumstances in which some sort of wording can take effect, cannot raise situations where you can have two people standing side by side, and one person can be saying something and another person can be saying exactly the same thing, but one person is guilty because of their racial or ethnic background and one person is not.
Okay. The Bolt case has been raised and it was cited by the Attorney-General as the catalyst for all of this. So let's talk a bit about that. Why was that case the catalyst?
I think it was because we ultimately had a high-profile columnist who was taken to court under Section 18C, the Racial Discrimination Act. And there were a number of issues that were raised which even the judge himself identified were legitimate areas of public policy debate, and that in the end he was found to have breached and sole offender and then was not covered by the exceptions. And I think when we have a federal parliament that has the power to make laws specific to race, we do need to make sure we have free and open speech so that we can make sure we have proper assessment about those laws.
A lot of people watching this will have no idea what this was all about. Bindi, I want you to explain in part what it was about. You were one of the nine people who took the columnist, Andrew Bolt, to court. Why did you take him to court?
It's a long story, but mostly because over a number of years he had vilified myself and a number of other people based on our identification of race. And
based on you identifying as Aboriginal?
Yes. Yeah, that's right. And so, I mean, I knew that this attitude was out in the world, that people thought that if I identified as being Aboriginal, it was because it was for political and career clout, which is what he said. But the way that he brought it about was really hurtful and humiliating and offensive and insulting and intimidating, and he did it over a number of years. And so I guess at the end of the day, after suffering through this, we decided that we would take him to court.
The case was about one column in particular, though, and in that column he referred to what he described as white Aborigines, yes, identifying as Aboriginal and being eligible for public grants and prizes. He was critical of that. You were one of those people he singled out in that column.
That's right.
Do you think he had a right to raise the issue?
Yes, I do think he had a right to raise the issue. In fact, I've made artwork about the issue as well, and I've spoken about it. And I think there is a place to discuss these types of attitudes in the community and in the public and in the press. It's just how you go about it. When you vilify people in the process, there's a problem, especially when you're vilifying them without any factual evidence or proper journalism.
So what did you regard as the vilification aspect of the column?
That he was accusing me of being something that I wasn't. And then not only that, he was then putting these types of things on his blogs, and then hundreds of people would get on and spew hatred at us.
How did the column affect you? Like, what reaction did you have to it?
Some days I didn't want to leave the house. I spent a lot of time crying and upset, and I felt humiliated and, like, intimidated by the whole thing.
We did invite, I should point out, we did invite Andrew Bolt to join us tonight, and he wasn't able to come for legal reasons. Jonathan, I know that you were troubled by the decision against Andrew Bolt in this case. Why?
Not because I admired or enjoyed the columns, I can assure you of that. But I did feel... I'd not looked at Section 18C of the Racial Discrimination Act before the Bolt case. I'm not a lawyer, it's not what I do. And when I did read it, I was frankly amazed that it was unlawful to offend or insult or humiliate people. I thought that was an extraordinarily low bar to make something unlawful for whatever reason. But you can do it, says 18D, in good faith, reasonable That's public right. discussion, right? And I assumed, I have to say, that Andrew Bolt would get away with that. He made a lot of mistakes, stupid, factual errors, sloppiness, and that would have meant that under the defamation law, for example, he would have lost. It's not fair comment if your comment is based on wrong facts. But the judge said, even if he got his facts right, I would have found against him because it was not reasonable and in good faith because of its tone, because of its dismissiveness. In the end, it was a judicial judgment about the tone of what he wrote that made it unlawful.
And you think it shouldn't be unlawful? Tone shouldn't be unlawful?
I thought that that's a real problem. I don't think that judges should be set up to make comments about or to make judgments about the tone of something that's written in the press. I mean...
It was a very, very vigorous tone. I can't read it out, Jenny, but it was...
If insulting and offending people were a problem in general, Media Watch would cease to exist. I do it every week.
Saying it's a tone diminishes it. There was a lot of inflammatory language and it was really full on. It wasn't just a tone. It was more than that.
They were horrible columns, Bindi. I thought they were disgusting. But I don't think they should be illegal. That's the difference.
OK. Jeremy, you've been involved in a number of successful cases under the current racial discrimination law. I know you're worried about the way incitement is dealt with in these proposals. Why?
Now, I'm worried with the whole law. The reason we have the laws 18C and 18D came about because there was an identifiable problem of racism in Australia. There were inquiries into what was happening to the quality of life of many individual Australians because of racism. And I can tell you, as a complainant, it's extremely difficult to convince judges of everything that's required, given the level of defences under 18D, given the number of exceptions.
OK, so tell us the kinds of things that you've objected to under the current law that have been upheld.
An example of a person spending basically every free moment, certainly every weekend, putting leaflets under people's windscreen wipers, cassettes in their mailboxes, basically saying that whatever the social problem is in the world, Jews are behind it, setting that template. There was another case of somebody, and that was over a number of years, somebody with a website with huge volumes of material. They advertised in the Australian newspaper, interested in history, come to this website. People went to that website and found it full of material claiming there hadn't been a Nazi Holocaust, that there was never a Russian revolution, it was a Jewish takeover of Russia, that every Jewish person in the world was your enemy and they were evil. This was all on the one website. Then there was a situation of a newspaper of a small political party which claimed that the internet was invented by Jews so that we could flood the world with pornography and then when the world was sick of pornography, control the internet and therefore control minds as part of alleged political debate.
So all of those examples you won under the current law?
In all those cases, yeah, the judges came to the conclusion, sometimes one judge, sometimes on appeal, to the conclusion that we satisfied all the difficult matters to say these were outside law in Australia.
And would they be satisfied under the proposed changes?
None of them would be.
OK. Jonathan, what do you think about that threshold around those sorts of issues?
Look,
Because that involves offending and humiliation and so on. Yeah. Doesn't necessarily involve
Well, some of the examples that Jeremy mentioned, I'm surprised that they wouldn't be covered by vilification as it's now defined. But I bow to your superior knowledge. I mean, I would think they should be. Things that are clearly are, to my mind, incitement to hatred. I'm surprised if that's the case, but you tell me it is. I don't know.
Can we just say, we don't believe they would, but until you actually test things under the law, you don't really know whether they would or not. But with our experience of how difficult it is under the existing law, which people seem to think is some onerous burden on everybody's right to free speech, it's extraordinarily difficult to win. Even under the current law.
Okay,
so with a new threshold, much harder.
OK, I'm going to move on. Natalie, you describe yourself as a brown-skinned lawyer and dancer who's not afraid to speak her mind. That's your description. what sort of abuse has been hurled at you?
All sorts of abuse since I was a kid. I've been called all sorts of swear words, which I won't repeat with the word brown in front of them. I've been called curry muncher, I've been told go back to your own country. I've been told when I was little that I must have green blood. And every time I thought it wasn't right, but I never once thought they didn't have a right. Because for me, and there's a lot of people here and watching that would have felt the pain that I felt and been, torn apart by insults daily and wonder why do people say such horrible things? But I don't think the law is the answer. I think the answer is we want a society where people don't just not say things because they're scared of getting prosecuted. They don't say them because they choose not to, because they know better. And that's where soft measures like education, sports, music, food, all those sorts of things come into play. And I really think that that's the best way to go with this.
OK, so what do you think the law should do?
I think...
Anything?
And as it's been discussed by a few people, I tend to agree with the new proposal about the words insult, offend, humiliate not being included, purely because it's such a broad thing. And in my experience, anyway, with the current laws, I still got insulted, offended and humiliated all the time. So at a practical level, in the ground level, I don't think those laws, I don't think the people who called me a brown bee stopped and thought, oh, wait, does 18C apply? No, I'm not going to say that.
What if they didn't said it to you in an article
and
called you a curry
muncher? I wouldn't agree
with him. And what if lots of people did it simultaneously in lots of media outlets?
I would think it was a horrible thing. I would try and start my own blog and maybe start my own thing against it, and I would think there'd be a lot of support in the community against that. But I still wouldn't think that he didn't have a right.
Michael, what about you? You've been racially abused as well, growing up in Australia. What sort of things have been said to you?
Oh, all kinds of horrible things. I grew up in the Southern Shire, so that was basically my entire childhood. And that's not...
I'm sure there are many good people living in the Southern Shire.
Oh, totally. Yeah. But, there's... as an example, my teachers used to say kind of racist things to me, one time for Chinese New Year... I don't even speak Chinese, but they made me parade out in front of the assembly dressed in like a hat and stuff, and all the kids were calling me some pretty horrible rhymes. It was pretty hurtful.
So what do you think about the changes to the law?
Well, I don't think they're protecting me, because I think I have a platform now where I can respond, you know what I mean? So they're not for me. They're for people who are actually disenfranchised. Like, I can go around Australia and white people can pay me money so that I can make fun of them. Like, do you know what I mean? So I'm not the one at risk here. But there are people who don't have, you're saying that you would start a blog and try and respond to it, but a lot of people don't have access to those kind of things, and that's who the law is there to protect. It's there to protect people who don't...
Do they have access to the law then, either?
No, that's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying, you need... that's what the law is there to protect them, though.
Do you think the law should be kept as it is, or do you think? What do you think?
Well,
I think we've
exposed a lot of problems with the proposed changes to the law, and I think keeping it as it is better than the changes that were being proposed. Yes.
Tim, I know that you've had hate speech directed at you, haven't you?
Well, I've had speech directed at me that's designed to be humiliating on the basis of my sexuality. Yes.
Okay, and what sort of things have been said?
I don't want to go into details because in some way it might glorify or validate the people who made them, but certainly in written publication, and I'm talking about one that was distributed within a small community at a very large extent, I've been mocked and humiliated because of my sexuality at length, at a point where obviously I'm not in a position to do anything. It was distributed to 10,000 people who knew me in a community, and it was very hurtful.
Did you think about taking legal action?
I have no basis to take legal action. One of the great misnomers or misunderstandings of this discussion is that these laws only apply to race and people don't have equivalent capacity around issues of sexuality. But I think we need to remind ourselves that it isn't just about the law. Just because something is lawful does not make it acceptable. There are plenty of things that are unacceptable but are also lawful. And it's really important in a civil society that we all take responsibility for the conduct that's engaged with amongst all of us. So when people swear and say inappropriate things, people stand up and speak up and say that's unacceptable. They choose not to associate with people who engage in that sort of conduct. And that's one other measure in which we can very effectively use to make sure without silencing people that we show our displeasure, disapproval, and limit what people say in an appropriate way.
Well, can I just say that that did actually happen and it didn't change the result with the mural. So the mayor at the time asked Sergio to remove the mural and he refused to. In fact, over 50 people graffitied over it. There was community protest in Newtown. We very specifically expressed our distaste of this kind of mural and it wasn't taken down. There was no common sense.
And he has a right to free speech, to communicate those views as you do, to respond exactly in turn and stand up and say that you dislike this person, what they stand for, why they stand for it, and to mock and ridicule him in return.
Oh, absolutely, but I can't switch off that mural. I can't just choose not to look at it. On my way to work, on my way to school, on my way to yoga, I just can't do that. So it's not fair.
So, Joe, quick response from you.
I work on a simple fact. I don't believe in minority rule. And the fact is that a handful of people don't have the right to dictate to me how I'm going to live or my rights to actually be able to express myself.
Can I ask you, would anything stop you? Would anything stop you?
At this point, no.
How do you think the impact of your so-called conversation starter is going to affect your children when they grow up?
I agree with you that there is a danger, but the problem with that is that as an adult of now, if we can't talk about things in a civil manner, no matter what the topic is today, we can't just pass it on to our children to solve the problem.
Do you have a rule of thumb about who can joke about whom?
It's mostly thoughtful people can joke about thoughtful things and other people aren't allowed to because they're idiots.
Tell us. Michael, does it matter who's making jokes based on race? Do you have a rule of thumb about who can joke about whom?
It's mostly thoughtful people can joke about thoughtful things and other people aren't allowed to because they're idiots.
Tell us... It's a nice, modest view. Tell us about the idea of punching up.
So I think what you're referring to is the idea of, like, who are you targeting your comedy at?
Yeah.
So I think... An idea might be like, you know, someone in a position of privilege, a man making a joke about a woman, right? Now, in that kind of power dynamic, you know, societally, I think we would all agree that women are not in a position of privilege, so you'd be punching sort of down. Not physically, obviously, so it's the, you know, the presentation of the joke, you know.
You have a go at people who are more privileged than you are?
I think the idea is you should be trying to, you know, hold truth to power, whatever. You know, you're trying to take on... people who are more powerful than you, because if you're not, you're taking on people who are less powerful than you, and what you're doing is just bullying, really.
Let's have a look at you punching up.
Oh, don't do that. I'm not saying that all white people are pedophiles, right? I'm not saying that all white people are pedophiles. I want to be very clear, I'm not saying that all pedos are white people. I'm not saying that all pedos, like, the white people are pedos, right? What I am saying, though, is it's a matter of stereotypes, yeah? Like, how many more white pedos do we have to find before I can start making jokes about how white people are pedos, you know? Because, like, if I'm driving a car down the street and I, like, try and park it, and as I back it in, like, hit the curb, everyone around me is going to be like, "Boh, Asian drivers! Fuck that, you guys!"
How many more white pedos do we have to find before I can see, like, a white guy standing next to a schoolgirl at a bus stop and just be like, classic white pedo?
Does anyone find that offensive?
That's been decontextualised a lot, I just want to say.
This is television.
Not just as a joke, but
we
like...
We couldn't run your whole routine, right?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, yeah. But just so everyone knows, that's part of, like, a much longer bit, and that bit is part of a much wider show about... I feel like that
okay,
probably
so it's about...
misrepresents slightly.
It made sense to you. Yes. Anyone offended by it? And I'm interested in whether anyone
I mean, as
was...
a joke, like, probably people didn't laugh, and I just wanted you guys to know, like, the whole bit's a bit funnier.
Okay, did anyone find it offensive?
No
one found
it's
it offensive.
It's a great joke, that's why.
Simon, did you find it offensive?
That's the example I gave before. You can't offend the powerful. It's perfectly appropriate to punch up. That's where you should be doing it. Punching down is what people in power can do and do because they can. It's the...
So because it was a joke about white men, no one found it offensive?
I agree with that. I think there are jokes about white men that could be offensive. I just don't think that's the one.
That's the one.
Up hard enough because, you know, if you get a reaction which of white people being offended by your act, doesn't that mean you've actually punched up the correct way?
Well, no, because if people are... I don't like this idea that the guarantee of offence is like that you're definitely doing the right job. That's not what... no one's intending to offend anyone.
But my point is, it's who's making the joke and it's who the joke is about.
I think a white person could do that joke.
That can determine whether it's offensive or not.
I think a white person could do that joke and it'd be fine, obviously, because it's talking about them as well. But that's... it doesn't matter who's telling that joke.
Yeah, I mean, but I'm interested in who's making decisions.
If it was told by a white person, it wouldn't sound funny. It wouldn't be funny. It wouldn't be a joke.
That's racist. No.
I'm raising this because I'm trying to raise the idea of who's making the comments and who's deciding what's offensive, because this is very much a part of what's involved in this proposed change to the law. Now, Tim, under the proposals, the standard for vilification or intimidation, which would be the new benchmarks, is based on what, and I'll quote, an ordinary reasonable member of the Australian community would think. Who is this ordinary reasonable person? Is it you? Is it me? Is it someone else here? Who is it?
No,
term for white person.
There are established precedents in existing law that deal with this. For instance, the Sex Discrimination Act around a reasonable person. But this proposal goes further, and this is why I think there is legitimate grounds to limit that section. I think there probably will be changes to that section to reflect the fact that it should be consistent with existing law.
OK, but you think it should be changed to more refer to the group being offended or the group being...
No, I'm saying the broad Australian community rather than a specific individual, because it's not as though a reasonable person test is a new thing that's established under this law. It exists under other laws, existed under previous law. In fact, there are many of them who operate across laws all across Australia.
Bindi, what do you think about this idea of who decides what's vilification and what's intimidating?
I think we should all have the right to decide.
But what do you think the law should say about that? What do you think about this change? Do you think it's a good idea or not a good idea?
I don't think it's a good idea at all. I think it should stay the way that it is, and that there should be laws that protect people, individuals or groups in these areas.
Jenny?
Okay, yeah.
Well, it seems to me what you're asking is where do we think it should be, that mysterious barrier? I mean, to me, it's got to be about violence in the end, that there has to be something about what was said that either threatens violence, incites violence, leads to the social fabric breaking down in some way or other. Mere insult, I say mere, I'm sure that, you know, and I'm a white bloke, and, you know, I feel very uncomfortable almost taking a stand on this because I don't suffer from this personally. But, and I'm very conscious of that, but I mean, insult and offence is not enough in itself.
Well, this is exactly
for
what
the Lord
and I were talking about beforehand. And if you're uncomfortable saying it, then think twice about whether you should be saying it.
You want the law to stop people from saying it, do you?
There's a certain freedom of speech here. You know?
I respect the fact that at the moment the law does prevent me from saying it because I am... it's impossible to offend me because of my race, OK? I'm impervious to offence. I'm a white, male, middle-class, married, heterosexual man. It's pretty hard to offend me.
OK. Jonathan? Do you think you might feel differently if you weren't a white middle-class man?
Oh, very possibly, Jenny. What I don't accept is that my whiteness means I have no right to speak in this matter.
No, I don't think anyone's suggesting that. That's why you're here.
This is the vibration I'm getting from in front of you there. I don't accept that. The people that invented freedom of speech, people like John Stuart Mill, were white Anglo-Saxon philosophers. They, if you like, were the people who lie behind this whole concept of freedom of speech in the Anglo-Saxon cultures, right? I don't think that's a culturally elitist thing to say or a racially elitist thing to say.
OK, we do have to wrap up. Just before we do, Sergio's made it clear that he'll keep going with what he does no matter what happens. Angelo, I wonder whether you'd do things differently next time, you two, with your event.
Absolutely.
How?
I'd want to have a more balanced panel so that people would feel more confidence that we're representative of society.
Yeah, if we'd known that everybody else was going to pay attention, because nobody ever pays attention to anything that we do. we're comedians, man. Like, so if we knew people were going to pay attention... Yeah, we would have put the word jokes at the end of the thing because that's what we were actually talking about.
OK, we do have to wrap up. Simon, do you think there should be any change to the law or you just want it exactly the way it is now?
The really important thing is that the law stands for a great deal more than something you take to court with.
So it should stay
and
as
for
it
20
is?
Years, do you it's been to... an unremarkable statement of our position. I wouldn't change it a bit.
You wouldn't change anything?
Nothing.
OK. Tim, what do you think is going to happen? You're flagging pretty clearly you think the changes aren't going to go ahead in their current form.
I think there's a recognition that there can be changes that can set the balance in what I would think is a more correct position, but how that's going to take form, I don't know.
OK, well, thank you, everybody, for joining us. We are out of time. Do appreciate your time tonight. And that is it for us here, but you can keep talking, of course, on Twitter and Facebook. I wonder what you think about the proposed changes to that law. Let us know.
And that pink mark shows a very active, hot tumour.
OK, and let's have a look at the photo now.
Well, this is 2 months later. He's done the HSC trials in this time.
So about a year ago, you were in palliative care.
Yes, literally a year ago.
And now you're sitting here.
I am, and I'm alive.
It does sound like someone else's life, if they've got breast cancer, is worth more than mine.
A community event, people getting together to fundraise, saved Melissa's life. Simple as that.
We'll be back next week. Stay tuned now for Dateline. Thanks, everyone.